What do you think people imagine when they picture the Cecil Hotel?
Is there a room here that maybe somebody hasn't died in? I never got used to that. Never got used to that.
Throughout its history, the Hotel Cecil has always had a dark persona.
People call it Hotel Death.
This was a place where serial killers let their hair down, like Richard Ramirez, who would come back covered in blood, and no one's got a problem with that.
A hotel with a notorious past is the site of another bizarre case.
Elisa Lam from Vancouver, Canada, is missing.
The big unanswered question is, where is she?
The last footage that we have of her was inside the elevator. That's where the case starts to go askew.
She kept looking outside the door.
Why is the elevator not going anywhere? Is someone keeping her here?
Her hand movements are very strange and erratic.
Like she's conjuring a spirit.
It makes people wonder, is there something evil going on here? It just blew up.
In the web sleuth community, it created this feeding frenzy. If it's a murder, then you need a murderer.
You really don't have the full story.
She was running around trying to save her own life.
Bad things keep happening here over and over again.
This hotel was hiding something.
I would have never thought what was about to happen could happen.
This is the latest chapter in a dark history for the Cecil Hotel.
We're here today in the inaugural episode of Monsters and Mysteries Monday to talk about my review and thoughts about the production of and the chatter surrounding crime scene Vanishing at the Cecil Hotel. This is directed by the same guy who brought us the Ted Bundy tapes, also from Netflix, and so very quick kind of overview. It, in what I call a very traditional boilerplate kind of Netflix true crime documentary, which is, you know, foreboding music, high production values, no overarching narration. You only hear from people who were directly involved in the case or the story they're telling. It covers kind of the disappearance and then the discovery of the body of Elisa Lam, a student from British Columbia who was traveling by herself to the up the West Coast, starting at like San Francisco, and eventually found her way at the Cecil Hotel, which is kind of a very kind of shady, sketchy hotel with a very notorious and infamous past. It's right next to Skid Row, which is kind of this really big American ghetto. It was home to Richard Ramirez for a while. It's what American Horror Story Hotel was based on. And it's very infamous. It's kind of a place that's kind of like, I suppose, would be becoming known in the dark tourism kind of circles for people who want to go legend tripping, you know, going to these places that have these kind of histories. But what we're going to kind of talk about at first is kind of just what I thought of it. As I mentioned, it's very good, very kind of standardized. I don't want to say easy watching, but it goes down easy because of the way it's presented and the way it's kind of produced. There's no real hard to follow bits. It's all laid out really well. It's easy to follow. It kind of has a broken timeline, not so much because that's, you know, that's a stylistic way, but because it starts off with the disappearance and then the discovery of the body. Then at the very end in episode 4, you actually get to the story, the most likely scenario in which this poor woman went missing and ended up dead. So it's kind of, it's not necessarily a broken narrative, but it kind of feels that way just because of the way these things kind of work out. But it's very, I learned a lot I didn't know, and it's probably one of the cases I'd say the most bizarre. Of course, having said that, I also didn't really have a lot of the information that's then presented in this documentary, and that's kind of one of the main points of the documentary that I will address in a little bit. It primarily interviews, the big players are a couple of the internet sleuths, who I will address later, the coroner, the official coroner, and some of the detectives assigned to the case. Also, it has the former manager of 10 years from about, I want to say it was 2007 to 2017 or something like that, she said. She appears in the trailer with the blonde hair. So it was nice hearing from that perspective. They actually interviewed the guy who found the body. He's probably the most important player for reasons I'll get into. And so going forward, just know there's going to be some spoilers. So basically what this program does that I really liked was it kind of gave you a background on Elisa Lam. It kind of gave you a background on the Cecil Hotel, probably the two biggest components of this story for obvious reasons. The person who sadly and tragically ended up dead and the place where it happened. Everybody else, as important as they were, as especially the primary investigators and the guy who unfortunately found her, they really do feel kind of like supporting characters in this overarching story that has kind of been mythicized in the true crime community because of how bizarre it is on the surface. And it is really bizarre if you don't have all of the information that they then give you in this documentary. So that's the first two episodes. The third episode is where for me it got a little bit crazy, and I really didn't like it at first. The third episode is all about the internet sleuths and what ended up being eventually just this big, massive conspiracy, David Icke-esque, Alex Jones level. It's the FBI and the Cecil Hotel and the police and that kind of stuff. It's linked to tuberculosis and it's all sorts of this crazy stuff because of the shady past of the Cecil Hotel. And it really didn't sit well with me for about a day and a half until I actually went back and kind of thought about it. And I'm gonna get back to this later. But then episode four is what really ties it together. They bring in a psychologist who, while she didn't work with Elisa Lam, mentions that she did talk to the family and things that the family had said, and then kind of more postulates and hypothesizes what might have been going on. And it's far more realistic than, you know, the conspiracy between the LAPD and the Cecil Hotel. So when I went on to, you know, read what other people thought in Facebook groups, on Reddit, just on Google, there's a lot of kind of animosity being thrown toward this documentary. And it kind of reminds me of the Ted Bundy tapes where it was like, oh, it makes Ted Bundy look out to be like this handsome guy, which, side note, he was better looking than me, you know, and it's like, I think it's kind of tied to the, well, bad people must be ugly kind of, you know, way people think. But for the Elisa Lam episode and documentary, it really was, well, there was too much about the internet sleuths, and it wasn't enough about Elisa Lam, despite the fact there was, you know, because it's about her, there's a lot of coverage on her. There was a lot of, well, it was too many conspiracy theories. They didn't focus enough on her. They didn't bring the family on, which the family could have just not wanted to do it. You know, something simple like that. Maybe couldn't get a hold of it and you have a deadline or something. Which always kind of does look bad, but it doesn't always mean it is bad. It just might mean that they didn't want anything to do with it. Because, you know, this is obviously going to be a hard subject for them to talk about. On that note, I think the guy who found her body, I think he held it together pretty well. I would not be comfortable talking about something like that. But I think that's kind of like part of the point of the documentary, was kind of diving into this other stuff, because it is a tragedy on the one hand between this family and the loss of their daughter, you know, which is a very big thing, something no parent really should ever have to deal with. But on the other, in the true crime community and on the internet, it became this massive kind of mystery because the elevator video, although yes, it was slowed down, even if you speed it up, it is kind of bizarre. It's just not a way that people would normally behave. And because of that, the internet really kind of grabbed onto it and took that and tore it to pieces into tiny minutiae. And so I think that's also a big part of the story. You can't talk about the Cecil Hotel and Elisa Lam unless you also talk about the implications that has for society overall. And I think looking back after having sat and been like, I don't like how they did this for that one episode, especially after having watched the fourth episode, it does feel kind of like this is a foil of the earlier Netflix documentary that was very well received, Don't Fuck With Cats, which, as you'll remember, was all about the internet sleuths. It was about how the internet sleuths saved the day. It was about how they dissected the scenes. And I don't remember there being a whole lot in that documentary about the murder victim. They kind of cover him, but it really wasn't like super about him. It was about the internet sleuths, you know, tracking down this horrible killer. And all of the things that are leveled against the Elisa Lam documentary weren't really leveled at the Don't Fuck With Cats documentary, even though Elisa Lam covered Elisa Lam more than Don't Fuck With Cats covered the victim of the actual murder. No one really kind of, at least when I looked up the internet chatter, I didn't see a whole lot of, well, it was too much about the internet sleuths. It wasn't enough about the guy who was, you know, killed. And you know, they talk in the Cats documentary about how horrible the sleuths felt having to watch the video of the killer playing with the decapitated head in the bathtub. But in the Elisa Lam documentary, I guess, talking about how the internet sleuths thought there was some conspiracy between the LAPD and the Cecil Hotel was somehow too much, right? And this really made more sense to me as a viewer when I watched it kind of as a foil to Don't Fuck With Cats. I mean, it's only that one real episode and then part of episode 4 where you kind of realize, wow, these are people who are kind of acting on this very basic human instinct of, we need a story, but we don't have all the facts, therefore, we're gonna come up with something. And it ends up with part, I think, of episode 3, the conspiracy episode. The thing that I think is the most kind of important is this poor musician, Morbid, out of Mexico, who posted a video of him at the Cecil Hotel a year earlier, who then these internet sleuths, who are like picking apart and thinking of conspiracies because they're not, you know, in the investigation, they don't have all the pertinent evidence for obvious reasons. They go, it's him. He starts getting a bunch of angry emails. He gets his music career is ruined because you have these internet sleuths who are self-described who don't have all of the evidence. And they kind of react to that and they think there must be something big here. So they think he's the murderer and they peg him as the murderer and they publicly identify him as the murderer despite the fact they are not cops, despite the fact they don't have the evidence. And that's kind of the entire point of episode 3, was these people not having enough evidence, not having all the information they should have. And that's kind of, I think, part of the point of this documentary, is a proper foil to Don't Fuck With Cats. You know, it's, yes, internet sleuths can be good. They can be very helpful if they know what they're doing. But if they're not, if they're, you know, as the sleuths and crime scene did, where they went to the Cecil Hotel and basically legend tripped or, you know, did some dark tourism to go see where this woman had been before she died, find out where her body was, you know. They were doing it for other reasons, and as a result, somebody's life was almost ruined because of this. And I feel that when people say it wasn't, like, you didn't need this in the documentary, it detracts from it. I think it kind of detracts from, like, the actual tragedy of her death a little bit, but there's another tragedy that I didn't know about that it showed me that was basically because people on the internet jumped to conclusions without having all the pertinent information because they're not part of the police or the family, and they just want answers, and so they run with it and they cause more damage than they don't. If you go back to the To kind of compare it to like the Night Stalker documentary, this would be really comparable to when they told the mayor of, was it, I forget what town it was, but then she basically held a press conference and gave away all the information that would have helped prevent false confessions, would have helped them identify the killer just to the public. You know, this is, that's kind of why they don't give out all the information. That's why these internet sleuths didn't have all the information. So I think that's a very important part of this documentary. I think it's important that they basically, in my mind, solved what happened, because now, you know, they told us, okay, major spoilers if you didn't already guess, but because we knew that Elisa Lam had stopped taking her medication, something that she had a history of doing, because she had a history of like hiding under her bed, thinking people were coming to get her, because she had this kind of extreme, unfortunate mental issues due to bipolar that caused her to react in a way that normal people wouldn't react. And so when normal people, I don't mean to say normal as like a, you know, like she was abnormal. I mean like, you know, people who generally don't have this response, even if they do have bipolar, like they would look at that and not, and think like, that's really bizarre, right? But one of the things that you kind of learn as you kind of read about these kind of mental health issues is that, or even just when with like just the way the brain works, is that there's an internal logic that makes sense, that but because we are not in that mental mind state, we're not privy to it, so it just looks bizarre. So basically the ending of this documentary ends with the most plausible and, looking back, very, very obvious kind of conclusion, where she'd stopped taking her meds. They said that there were more meds than she should have had she been taking them as she was supposed to. And apparently she stopped taking them on her trip. There was a bunch of instances that kind of showed that, or demonstrated that she was kind of relapse is the word? I don't know. That the medication was wearing off and she was kind of entering this kind of, manic state, maybe? And basically became very paranoid and thought people were after her, something that her family had said happened, and then went up to the roof, tried to find a place to hide, saw the water tank, said that looks like a good place to hide, and then jumped in without realizing that there's no way to actually escape a water tank unless the water is absolutely full to the top. So that's what they say happened. That makes the most sense to me. But again, that's kind of why I think the people who say, well, they should, it's bad because it detracts from the case, I think it's very important, and it shows another very important lesson. Because like I said, it not only is it about the death of Elisa Lam, which is very sad and very tragic, and in a way is preventable. Like, there's a lot of things that could have been done differently, you know, just buy locks, you know, for the water tanks and, you know, that kind of stuff. But it also shows what happens when people do these kind of like self-investigations, quote unquote, thinking they're internet sleuths, thinking they're the kind of people who were featured in Don't Fuck With Cats. And then they go and they just make a mess of things and they muddle things up and then they kind of don't know what's going on, but they think they do. You know, it's kind of like what James Randi said, you know, it's okay to enjoy the thought and the story. Well, like, what if there was a cover-up between the Cecil Hotel and the LAPD to hide the fact that she was a plant for tuberculosis, which is, you know, kind of really disrespectful to this poor woman who died. But this was one of the, you know, one of the conspiracy theories. And if you want to think that way and have a little thought experiment, I suppose that's fine. But make sure you have a line drawn in the sand and you don't cross that line and you don't take it seriously. Because as James Randi said, that's to embrace madness. And it's very dangerous. And one of the reasons why I think people kind of reacted the way they did to this was, one, because these are very obviously stupid conspiracy theories that are very obviously disrespectful to an actual victim. But also, I think it's because it's basically the exact opposite of Don't Fuck With Cats, where it's internet sleuths who really aren't smart, they're just average people, and kind of ruin